Right. Okay, so this is the continuation of our lecture on the last 10,000 years, which is essentially looking at the origins of agriculture and the transition from hunting and gathering to relying predominantly on domesticated food production, so the domestication of both plants and animals. So last class period, we talked a lot about the pros and the cons of this transition. So some of the pros included more reliable food source, the ability to create a food surplus, the ability to support a larger population size, the ability to live a more sedentary lifestyle. So we didn't have to travel. Once we transitioned fully to domesticated food production, we no longer needed to travel 7, 8 miles a day just to gather enough food for survival. So we started to have time for things like symbolic expression. So we start to see an explosion of things like artistic expression, cave art, jewelry, statuettes, Venus figurines. So it's, likely that it wasn't that the hominins before this time weren't capable of it. They likely didn't have time for it because they spent the vast majority of their waking hours just getting enough food for survival. So we talked about last slide, we talked about on Thursday, correct me if I'm wrong, but we talked about the two scenarios, the what came first. Was it the large population size that came first, or was it agriculture that came first? And it's certainly very possible that this happened in different ways, depending upon what territory or what geographical region we're talking about. But the most supported hypothesis is the second one, scenario two, that the transition from hunting and gathering to agriculture came first, which then allowed for a more sedentary lifestyle, which allowed birth intervals to be decreased, which provided a reliable food source, and ultimately resulted in a larger population size over time. So that's what's supported most in the archaeological record, and that's what's supported most when we look at the population explosion. The population explosion did not occur until that transition occurred. So it's likely that the two were related. All right, so population pressure increased the need for a larger and more stable food resource, which, with the domestication, with the successful domestication of plants and animals, we were able to do that. So we know that plant domestication occurred in at least 10 to 11 regions around the world, but it began in the region known as the Fertile Crescent, or what we know today as the Middle East, essentially. So we focused a lot on domestication of plants on Thursday, but let's talk a little bit about domestication of animals because this was just as important as the domestication of plants. So let's watch a little video clip here that will talk about domestication of the animals. So as you're watching, I want you to think about what are the benefits? Why would humans benefit from domesticating animals? And then also, what are the benefits to the animals as well? This is going to be kind of a symbiotic relationship here. It's not only going to be beneficial to the early humans living during this time, but also to the animals that they were domesticating. And that may not sound intuitive because we know the animals that are domesticated today are not necessarily benefiting from that relationship. But in the very beginning, when we first started to domesticate animals, it was much more symbiotic. So think about the benefits for humans and also the benefits for the animals as well. And we'll talk about it after. Oh, and let me make sure that I optimized for sound clips here.
Twelve thousand years ago, early Europeans lived a hard life in nomadic bands. It was a way of life that had lasted for 100,000 years. Sheltering deep in their caves, they painted images of wild animals they hunted for food. For hundreds of generations, they had followed the herds, depending on them for survival. Now, they are about to face a new challenge. they will confront a different people from a different world. It will change them and all human life forever. The challenge started here on the green hills of the Middle East. Unlike Europe, the climate of the Fertile Crescent produced abundant food all the way from Israel to Iraq. Here, the hunter-gatherers lived very well, and they had learned to hunt with dogs. Dogs have been sitting in the sun with people for at least 12,000 years. They're our oldest companions on the human journey. So close, we're not even sure whether we tamed them or they tamed us. Dogs were a part of life and death. Inside a hut at Ein Malacha in Israel, archaeologists found a woman buried 11,000 years ago under the floor. Beside her head was a puppy. Whoever covered them took the trouble to place the woman's hand over the dog's body.
The Ein Malacha burials and the dogs really signal a shift in that human relationship between what had been a wild species, maybe an adversary, and now which is something that had become part of daily life and, as a matter of fact, even something that merits burial with the dead. And that's a big shift indeed.
The dogs were even more attracted to humans once they built huts.
Dog domestication comes with human sedentism, with people settling down and creating trash heaps and so on that are a lure and an attractant to the dogs. But it does set some sort of a precedence of bringing animals from the wild closer in to that human sphere of life.
The relationship with dogs must have set people thinking. Why not control other animals? It would provide a ready supply of meat and cut down on the hunting. But it took a crisis to push them forwards. The Middle East was hit with over 1,000 years of drought. It was caused by a short ice age called the Younger Dryas, which brought glaciers to Europe and famine to the Fertile Crescent. It was a climate catastrophe. Deep in the sand and suffering, the hunters changed their way of life. Some people escaped to the few oases with water and good soil. Here, they learnt to plant crops and became the world's first farmers. Others searched desperately for game across their traditional hunting lands, but the drought made the animals scarce. To save themselves, they took possession of their prey. The fireplaces of these hunters reveal the bones of goats, which were kept in herds. They were the very first domesticated farm animals. Archaeologist Melinda Zeda is tracking the way goats changed as they were domesticated. Her evidence comes from a huge collection of bones gathered from across the entire Middle East. The changes are most obvious in the horns.
You can see on this big guy here from the highlands of Iran, a wild Bezoar goat. He's got a very large horn. It's a sharply keeled. It's rounded in its sort of profile here. It goes back in what they call a scimitar shape. And this is very distinctive of the wild goat. It's quite different from what we see in this fellow here, this domestic goat, where it's the horn is now flattened on the inside, it's twisted, and obviously it's quite a bit smaller. Now the reason for that is that in the wild, this kind of a horn gives the males a competitive advantage in competing for females. In the domestic situation, the males aren't competing for females, but the herder is selecting who breeds with whom. So there's really no need for this large equipment.
Today in the Middle East, people are still herding goats in the same way. The first herders selected smaller and less aggressive animals, removing the very traits the animals needed to survive in the wild. In return, the herders provided food and protection. They soon added other animals to their herds. This one small part of the world supplied almost all our domesticated species. Alongside goats and sheep were pigs. This pottery figure from Turkey is 8,000 years old. Cows were early beasts of burden.
We tend to look at domestication of animals as a big lose-lose situation for the animals. But really, from a Darwinian perspective, it's a big win-win, because domestic animals, through their collaboration with humans, are able to out-compete their wild progenitors. For the humans, obviously, they're obtaining resources, either plant or animal. It may not be as nutritious or even as necessarily as bountiful a diet as they were getting from hunting and gathering, but there is an element of security and predictability that this kind of resource provides.
For the herders, it was a brilliant idea. By keeping the animals alive and breeding them, they guaranteed the supply of meat. The long drought of the Ice Age ended around 11,500 years ago. The world came back to life. Now, something truly remarkable happened. Two distinct ways of surviving, the herders and the cereal farmers, came together. They each had half of the puzzle. The herders had the animals, while the farmers were growing grain to feed the stock. For the first time in history, a ready supply of meat was brought together with cereals. Now the farming way of life.
All right, so you guys tell me, what were some of the benefits to the humans as far as animal domestication goes? So why would humans want to domesticate animals? Why was that beneficial to their survival?
They were able to ensure that they had a ready supply of meat.
Excellent. They were able to ensure they had a ready supply of meat. So they were selecting which animals were breeding. They were selecting what characteristics they wanted out of the animals. So they obviously weren't using all of them for meat, because they needed to keep a breeding supply ready to go. But they were using some of them for meat, and they were also using them for milk and for clothing, for the manufacture of clothing. Any other reasons why domestication of animals would be beneficial to humans?
They use them as like to like pull stuff and like as transportation and stuff like that.
Excellent. Yeah, they were used to haul supplies. They were used for transportation. They also talked about how as these animals are consuming the grass, they're also then, you know, their waste is then acting as a fertilizer. So they're having that symbiotic relationship with also creating a fertilizer for the regrowth of that pasture. So it's a symbiotic kind of relationship they've got going. All right, and it's beneficial for the animals because they have protection. They are less likely to be consumed by predators. They're less likely to be, you know, essentially to starve to death because they have the humans helping them out. They have humans protecting them from predators. Not that it's impossible. I mean, of course, even herders today, sometimes their cattle or their sheep or their pigs become prey to predators, but it's far less likely that they would be consumed by a predator if they're domesticated. And also it's far less likely that they would starve to death. So in the beginning, this is a very symbiotic kind of relationship. Now you can certainly argue that the way we practice animal husbandry today is quite different and it's not necessarily symbiotic anymore, but it certainly was more so 11,000 years ago. So plant domestication actually came a little bit later. Animal domestication came first, likely because of the drought caused by the ice age. So the Young Gadryas drought that happened because of the ice age forced them into domesticating animals slightly before they domesticated plants. So the plant domestication came a bit later once we came out of the ice age, once the ice age ended about 11,000 years ago, they were then able to have an environment where they could cultivate plants. All right, so the end of the Pleistocene, so the end of the last ice age, saw intense harvesting of wheat and barley's ancestors, which ironically enough, those are still some of the main grains that we rely upon for feeding the world population today. Manipulation of plant growth cycles began about 11,500 years before present. So that coincides directly with the end of the ice age. So it's, you know, obviously no surprise or no coincidence that this is all correlated. As we come out of the ice age, the climate becomes warmer and more stable. Carbon dioxide levels are rising, and that's allowing for plant cultivation. In the Jordan Valley and the Fertile Crescent, we see agriculture spread by about 8,000 years before present. So during that 3,000 year period, agriculture and plant domestication, animal domestication is spreading throughout the Fertile Crescent. And we also see the emergence of the earliest sedentary villages, the earliest year-round sedentary villages. Some of those are Jericho and Chattahoochee. And I'm going to show you some pictures of what they might have looked like. So these are artistic recreations based upon what we see in the archaeological record. So this region here, this map is just giving you a visual representation of the area we're talking about here. So that Fertile Crescent, it's called the Crescent because it's shaped just like a crescent. So that purple region there is what we know as the Fertile Crescent. What we know as today is basically the Middle East and Northern Africa. So that region today is very dry. However, 11,500 years ago, this was the most fertile region. So this is the region where we see the emergence of not only domesticated plants, but also the major animals that we've domesticated all come from this region, all come from the Middle East and Northern Africa. All right, so this is one of those artistic recreations of what some of these early villages might have looked like. So again, remember some of the problems that might have emerged. All of a sudden, humans are living in sedentary villages, so we have to figure out what to do with not only human waste, but also animal waste. So we have to figure out how to dispose of that and to prevent germs from spreading throughout the population. Disease also became a bigger factor because disease is a density-dependent factor. So if one person gets sick, it's far more likely that they're going to spread it to others if they're in close proximity to other humans. So we see an increase in sanitation issues. We see an increase in infectious diseases. We also see nutritional issues emerging because humans are focusing just on carbohydrates, just on grains, rather than eating the varied diet that they did as hunter-gatherers. We also see the emergence of aggrandizers and leaders. We also see the emergence of competition for access over land and resources, origins of inequality. Those are all linked to the origins of agriculture. All right. So animal domestication started around 15,000 years before present, and the earliest animal to be domesticated, probably no surprise, was the dog. So there's evidence that humans domesticated the dog as early as 15,000 years before present. It wouldn't surprise me if actually it began a little bit before that. It wouldn't surprise me if we find evidence in the archaeological fossil record that possibly even the Neanderthals were domesticating dogs. It's not impossible. But we do know, ironically enough, that only about 14 animal species have been successfully domesticated, and all of those animals are from Northern Africa and the Middle East. And I do have one more little clip for you on dog domestication. So this symbiotic relationship is one that goes back 15,000 years and obviously continues today. So again, as you watch this clip, think about the whys, essentially why, in evolutionary terms, why would it be beneficial for humans to domesticate a dog? And why is it beneficial for the dog as well? Let's explain the symbiotic reason or symbiotic relationship between the human and the dog. All right, this one is just a short clip. This is from a documentary on dog domestication from BBC, or the History Channel, actually, I believe. Oops. Let me pull it back up here. There it is.
The dog was the first animal to be domesticated somewhere between 15 and 13,000 years ago. What is unique about the dog is that its ancestors are basically wolves. So our ancestors and dog's ancestors were at some point maybe enemies.
Wolves are social creatures. They recognize dominance and sociality, so they're already, in a sense, pre-adapted to living with humans. The course of domestication of the dog was probably not a single moment. It was probably a long, long period of experimentation.
The first initial contact was probably made by wolves who were looking to exploit a new food source, who were able to, you know, stand being near people long enough to eat what was being thrown in the scrap heap behind the cave. And in a couple of generations, you've got an animal that is starting to domesticate. And I think it's what's fascinating about that is the sort of the conceptual shift for those early men into how useful that could be. I mean, of course, a domesticated dog is a tremendously useful tool in a survival situation in the wild.
They can watch the mouth of the dwelling for predators. And when humans and dogs begin to hunt together, their capabilities are greatly expanded. The wolf, who's a much better hunter than we are. So now all of a sudden we have that amazing sense of smell, the ability to track game.
He can hunt at night. He can hunt by sound. He can hunt by smell. He can hear the reindeer over the horizon hours before you'll even become aware of their presence. It's an unbeatable combination. There's humans and dogs together, nothing can stop them. We have a long relationship with the wolf and the dog, and it's often said the dog is man's best friend, but you can turn that around. Dogs will never become extinct. Wolves, on the other hand, are endangered species pretty much everywhere they live. So becoming man's best friend was a good thing for the wolves. No one's ever given up on the domesticated dog.
All right, so you guys tell me, what was the motivation? Why did humans want to domesticate dogs? Why is that beneficial to their survival?
For hunting.
Excellent, hunting. So dogs have a much better sense of smell than we do. Thinking way back to our section on primatology, humans and primates in general, we have an enhanced sense of vision and touch. But other mammals, like the dog or the wolf, they have an enhanced sense of sound, of smell and hearing. So that, when you think about it, that really makes us the perfect hunting partners, because the dogs, the wolves can rely on their sense of smell and hearing, and we can rely on our sense of vision. So that makes us really perfect hunting partners. Why else? Why else would it be beneficial for humans to domesticate the dog?
Well, dogs make very good guards as well.
Excellent. So protection. So that's kind of a mutually beneficial thing. So they're able to provide protection for us, and we also provide protection for them. Excellent. Any other reasons? Why humans might want to domesticate a dog?
Just as a friend.
Excellent. Companionship. That's what I was thinking of. Companionship.
Even to protect a human from any dangers that the dogs or wolves see.
Excellent. Excellent. Companionship, protection, hunting partners. These are all good reasons. All right. So interestingly enough, though, I think the dog is a perfect example. Can you guys imagine some of our domesticated dogs today surviving in the wild without our support, like a pug or a Cocker Spaniel, for example? Do you think they could survive very long in the wild without us?
No.
Probably not. So that's important to remember, that that's one of the downfalls of domestication, is it doesn't always, you know, especially when it becomes intensified like it has in modern day. Yeah, domestication is not...
It's to say if you were to put a human in a forest with other gorillas or chimpanzees, it's not really the same, because it's like
we've definitely adapted to a more domesticated lifestyle than we, you know, it's definitely something to think about. You know, certainly, you know, we wouldn't necessarily ever intentionally put our animals out to fend for themselves, but if they escape, or, you know, I'm sure many of you have experienced, you know, that as our territory begins to encroach upon those of coyotes and mountain lions, you know, they're definitely, well, we all of a sudden have to worry about our pets succumbing to being their dinner or their lunch or whatever it might be. So it's, you know, it's something that we have to consider as we continue on in this process of domestication. We have to make sure that we're not only breeding them for our benefit, but also for their benefit as well. Good thoughts. All right. Let's continue on. All right. So let's talk a little bit about how this domestication of both plants and animals has essentially been an adaptive trade-off, in the sense of we are certainly destroying our planet. I'll tell you why. And you don't have to take my word for it. I'll show you how this is destroying our planet, because, you know, of course, essentially population growth. We have over 8 billion people on the planet today. We've quite simply exceeded the carrying capacity. The environment cannot support the number of humans that are currently on our planet. So today, 2/3 of humans' necessary calorie and protein intake comes from the key cereal grains that were domesticated in the earlier Holocene. The Holocene is just the last 10,000 years. So we still, you know, interestingly enough, we still rely very heavily on wheat, barley, rice. Those are still the grains that we rely very heavily upon. And we know that, you know, this process of domestication has depleted the soil of nutrients in many cases and made it impossible for that soil to continue to support a large population size. We can't just continuously farm and deplete the soil of nutrients. Also, the animals that we domesticate are going to trample the soil. The animals that we domesticate release methane as they're passing gas. And I know that sounds silly, but that is definitely one of the number one contributors to global climate change, is this reliance upon the consumption of meat. So the more animals that we put out there in the environment that are then releasing this methane, that's considered to be one of the major contributors to greenhouse gases. So a reliance upon meat has certainly had an impact on our planet. So we see there's a, you know, marked correlation between the advent of agriculture, so essentially domestication of both plants and animals, and the steady population explosion. So we see it began about 10,000 years ago, and then it increased to present. We have over 8 billion people on the planet today. Along with this, we see an increase in interpersonal conflict. So we mentioned that earlier on in our lecture on Thursday. We mentioned that violence and interpersonal conflict emerge as we have competition, as we compete for access to resources and territory. all of a sudden, not all land is created equal. When we were hunting and gathering, obviously, we were all moving. We were all moving around. It wasn't beneficial for us to fight over one piece of land. But when we're practicing agriculture and domesticating plants and animals, it is all of a sudden necessary for us to compete over one piece of land, or the land that's the most fertile or the most near water or has animals that are easy for us to domesticate. So along with this, we have interpersonal conflict. So the next few slides just show some examples of what we see in the fossil record, the archaeological record. This is how we know that we see an increase or an uptick in violence right around the advent of agriculture. So we see cranial depression fractures. These are found on prehistoric Native American remains from Southern California. These are the result of blunt force trauma. We see these are evidence. So this is the frontal bone here. You're looking at the forehead, essentially. So you can kind of see down here, that's the eye sockets or the orbits. And we've got the supraorbital ridge. And then this is the frontal bone. So those scratch marks there, those cuts, those are cut marks on the cranium. This is a late prehistoric Native American from Norris Farm, Illinois, and evidence that the individual was scalped. These skeletons are the remains of victims of the Battle of the Ninth Century BC Iran. They were discovered on the floors of buildings that had been burned during the conflict. So these slides are just all examples of what we mean by interpersonal conflict. And this one is a puncture wound. This is a cranium, that's the temporal bone there. So we've got the frontal here, that's the parietal. And that's on the top of the temporal where it connects with the parietal. So that's a puncture wound. This cranium received its puncture wound during a late medieval massacre, the Battle of Towton in England. And this is another cranial trauma. This is another puncture wound that the individual died from because you don't see any healing. So you see that's happening. So we've got the frontal bone here and then the parietal. So that one's in both the frontal and the parietal. So this is cranial trauma, such as seen on the skull from 19th century Austria. All right, and along with increase in violence, competition for land and resources, we see environmental degradation. So that's essentially the destruction of our environment. The process of domesticating and raising plants and animals reduces overall world biodiversity, and unchecked population growth could lead to a food crisis. I would argue it already has. Because essentially, as our population grows, we need to clear more and more land for our houses, our cities, our structures, our businesses, our highways. You guys get the picture. But the larger our population size is, the more we need to encroach on the territory of other organisms. So we can see that this degradation is well documented and began around 10,000 years before present, as we began domesticating both plants and animals. So this process in the early days, 10,000 years ago, it wasn't necessarily catastrophic for the planet. But I think you could certainly argue that, you know, we find ourselves in a place 10,000 years later where it is catastrophic for the planet, that we can no longer continue along the same path and have any hopes that, you know, I'm sure the planet will be fine, but we can't certainly have any hopes that we will be fine, because, you know, essentially the planet might do a reset on us. The planet might, there may be some sort of cataclysmic event or another ice age that essentially wipes out a good segment of the population. So we have to keep that in mind. We know that cultural and technological changes also have some negative effects on our planet. So what I mean by that is essentially the machinery that we need to engage in agriculture, the machinery that we need to get from point A to point B, burns quite a bit of fossil fuels. During the Before the Flood, there's an extra credit discussion this week on Before the Flood. It's a documentary, and then it also has you do a carbon footprint test. And you'll see just how heavily reliance upon fossil fuels impacts your overall carbon footprint. And sorry, guys, I need to update this slide. Population has increased from 2 million to over 8 billion in the last 10,000 years. That's how quickly it's happening. This slide was made not more than 5 years ago, but I already need to update it. So that should say 8 billion, not 7 billion. So this population explosion has inevitably resulted in competition for resources and then strains the global environment. So again, you know, this environmental concern is not only an environmental concern, it's also a political one, because as we continue to compete for land and resources, that's only going to increase interpersonal intergroup conflict. So, you know, we see it happening all the time. Generally, the wars that we fight or that we see fought are over land and resources. That's not something new. That's something that's been happening for 10,000 years. So it's important to remember that it's, you know, caring about the environment is not just about the environment. It's also about making sure that we have a safe place to live as well. The more that this competition increases, I predict the more conflict we'll see. All right, biological changes. So let's talk a little bit about the anatomical changes that we see, the biological evolution that's occurring. So human evolution has and will continue to the present and in the future. Some of the most recent changes can be linked to the agricultural revolution and also shifting to a diet that's really focused on soft food items, essentially. So think way back to when we learned about the Australopithecines, when we learned about the gracile forms and the robust forms. The robust forms are really distinctive looking as far as their cranial and dental features. They have the really large premolars and molars. They have the extremely robust jaw, the zygomatic flare is extreme. The sagittal crest where the jaw muscles attach is prominent. So we see these really distinctive features that are associated with the robust forms, and that's linked back to their diet. They were consuming really rough, tough food items. Whereas in comparison, the gracile forms had more delicate features. They did not have a sagittal crest. They had smaller premolars and molars. They had a less robust jaw. And then especially once you get to genus Homo, you see it even further reduce. So, and that's generally linked with the adoption of both fire and tools. Because when you think about it, if you're able to cook something, it makes it much softer. If you're able to use a tool to process it, to break it down, and then you can cook it, it's a lot softer and easier to consume. The easiest way to think about it is think about eating a raw potato versus eating mashed potatoes. Obviously, it's a lot easier on the jaw, requires a lot less chewing pressure to consume mashed potatoes. So when we're looking at the last 10,000 years, it's just become even more extreme, essentially. So we're focusing on carbohydrates, we're cooking our food before we consume it, we're using tools to process it before we consume it. So we no longer have this extreme pressure on our jaws. So generally, this is considered to be the predominant hypothesis as to why we have more gracile facial shape, why we have smaller dentition, why some of us have to have our wisdom teeth removed, essentially, is because we are consuming a much softer diet. So we call it the masticatory functional hypothesis, is stating that the changes in skull form are a direct response to decreased demands on the chewing muscles. So again, just like diet really changed the craniofacial shape of the robust Australopithecines, same thing for our recent evolution, our soft diet, our reduction of stress and pressure on the chewing muscles has created a much more gracile and delicate structure. Also, many of us have needed to have our wisdom teeth removed. It's very possible that someday our dental formula may be 2-1-2-2 instead of 2-1-2-3. But essentially, this is due to we have less reliance upon the premolars and molars. We need less crushing force because our food is already so soft. All right, so again, the masticatory functional hypothesis. This is the hypothesis that craniofacial shape change during the Holocene was related to the consumption of softer food items. It sounds simple, but that's the theory that has the most support, because we can see that diet absolutely influences craniofacial shape, also the size and orientation of our dentition. This is all influenced predominantly by diet. All right, also things like malocclusions. So a malocclusion is basically a fancy way of saying an overbite or an underbite. So an overbite occurs when the maxillary teeth, so just a little bit of review, remember the maxilla, that's the upper jaw, the mandible is the lower jaw. So an overbite occurs when the maxillary teeth extend farther forward than the mandibular teeth. And then an underbite is simply the opposite. An underbite occurs when the mandibular teeth extend farther forward than the maxillary teeth. So we don't really see a whole lot of evidence for malocclusions, for dental caries, for enamel hypoplasias. We don't really see a whole lot of evidence for these dental issues until the last 10, 11,000 years or so. And again, many theorists feel like it's no coincidence that it's this reliance upon a heavy carbohydrate diet, a reliance on a much softer food items is going to relate in these crowded jaws, is going to result in these crowded jaws and other detrimental things. All right, so also changes in the postcranial. So again, throwback way back to the human adaptation lectures when we talked about Wolf's Law. So we know that bone will respond to stress, and how active a population is will affect the robusticity of their bones. So essentially more active populations are going to have more robust, thicker postcranial skeletons. So when we compare hunters and gatherers to those of sedentary agriculturalists, when we look at their postcranial anatomy, we see the hunter-gatherers have much more robust, thicker bones in comparison to the sedentary agriculturalists. So essentially the bone will respond to stress. How hard someone works will affect the skeleton. Studies of the strength of bones in different populations illustrates response to changing workloads. So essentially the more active a population is, the more robust their skeleton will be. All right. Okay, so we also see, like I mentioned on Thursday, we're going to see an uptick in infectious diseases because remember, disease is a density dependent factor. So essentially what that means is once humans are living in population dense sedentary villages, it's going to be more likely that disease is going to spread. So we see with increasing population size, we see an uptick in the spread of infectious diseases. We know that bones can reveal the presence of infections. Trypanosomiasis affected many populations around the world, and tuberculosis also was found early around the world as well. So we're going to see some examples of this. So what we're looking at here, we're looking at the frontal bone of the human crania. So you see all of these kind of like undulating pop marks here. This is actually these lesions are the result of trypanosomiasis, and the undulating surface of the skull shows active and healed lesions caused by the disease long, slow progression. So essentially, this is what would happen prior to the advent of modern day antibiotics and the use of, you know, the way that the knowledge that we need to take care of something like this before it becomes a major issue. But of course, early agriculturalists didn't necessarily understand that concept. All right, also dental caries or cavities increased after certain plants were introduced, which, you know, to us may sound like no big deal. Like, why is this a big deal? We get a cavity, we just go to the dentist and get it taken care of. But when you think about it, a cavity is essentially an infection. A cavity is an infection that if it's not taken care of, it will spread to the gums and then it may spread to the bone. So for early agriculturalists, a cavity that wasn't taken care of properly could actually lead to death if it was severe enough. So, and that you definitely can, teeth, you know, one of those things that really do survive the fossil record or survive, you know, for longer than some other bones, essentially. So we do have lots of evidence that we see an uptick or increase in dental caries that correlates with the advent of agriculture. We also see abnormal development, so lack of essential nutrients leads to overall smaller body size and even developmental abnormalities. And we know that bones and teeth provide excellent ways of assessing dietary changes and nutritional deficits. So essentially, we're focusing in on just one or two crops, which is not giving us a varied enough diet. So it's causing dental caries or cavities. It's leading to nutritional deficiencies that are affecting our overall height. It's sometimes causing abnormal growth of our bones. So these are all some of the things we start to see around the advent of agriculture. These are just some pictures of what I mean when I say cavities. So again, cavities are more common among individuals with carbohydrate-rich diets as a result of digestion of carbohydrates. These caries lesions form as the teeth enamel deteriorates. And in extreme cases, the teeth pulp can be affected, and even the bone underneath. So those extreme situations are when this can be even a deadly, you know, a deadly result for the human involved or humans. All right, these are enamel hypoplasias. So it might be kind of hard to see, but there's an arrow pointing to them here. You see these distinctive lines in the tooth enamel. These enamel hypoplasias, these are defects that reflect stress episodes that occur during tooth development. Individuals with multiple hypoplasias on each tooth underwent several stress episodes. All right, iron deficiency was also an issue. Obviously, if we're focusing in on just carbs, we're not getting a very iron-rich diet. So we see evidence of this in severe cases of anemia, parotid hyperostosis, and Kriba orbitalia. Let me show you some better pictures of that. This one here, this is parotid hyperostosis. So what you're looking at here is the crania from a superior view. So you're looking at it from above, looking down. So you've got the frontal bone here and then the parietals. So you see this expansion and porosity of the cranial bones due to severe anemia caused by a severely iron deficient diet, parasitic infection, or genetic disease. So just like with cavities, we see an uptick of parotid hyperostosis right around the advent of agriculture. So it's, you know, likely not a coincidence. It's likely that this shift to a carbohydrate-rich diet and, you know, the shift away from the varied diet of hunter-gatherers was definitely detrimental to humans, at least in the beginning, at least till we figured out that we needed to vary our diet. All right, this is another piece of evidence for iron deficiency. So this is called Kriba orbitalia. So you break that word up. Remember, the orbits are the eye sockets. So it's affecting the eye sockets here. So Kriba orbitalia, Kriba orbitalia is porosity in the eye orbits due to anemia caused by severely iron deficient diets, parasitic infection, or genetic disease. All right, so we talked about all these negatives. We talked about a lot of the pros too, but we talked about a lot of the cons today as well. So if we have all these detrimental things going on, why farm in the first place? So essentially, the big hypothesis is essentially agricultural practices increased human fertility, it lowered energetic demands on females, and it reduced birth intervals. So remember, when we're talking evolution and we're talking reproductive success, whatever increases that reproductive success is going to be what those humans decide to do. So essentially, the benefits, you know, at least the nice, sparkly, fancy benefits that they could see from the beginning are likely what attracted and influenced our ancestors to decide to transition to agriculture. All right, so do you guys have any questions for me about anything in that lecture? Anything at all? Okay, so let's go ahead and